My name is Jimmy Barrera. I work as a manager for the 3D printing and 3D scanning application engineering team. I've been at Cimquest for 14 years. When I started with Cimquest, I was a SOLIDWORKS application engineer. I started doing tech support, then migrated over to teaching courses at Cimquest. Then at the end, I was doing demos, pre-sale demos, visiting companies and helping them integrate their CAD software into their actual projects they were working on. So I kind of started doing mostly consulting towards the end. After that, I started getting into scanning. I did that for a few years. We adopted scanning into our process. We were selling scanners and scanning software. And about 3 or 4 years ago, I started getting into 3D printing here at Cimquest. One example of a project that we recently completed where we're testing out the machine's capabilities is this multi-tool here. The idea behind this multi-tool was to come up with a part that we can give away to our customers that are interested in our technology and to be able to understand the value of metal 3D printing. If we can develop a type of tool out of metal that was printed and handed out, that was gonna be key. We went through different phases. I guess the first phase was the design phase. We used SOLIDWORKS right in-house, started CADing up our idea. We got together with the team, had many ideas. With SOLIDWORKS, you can go through different iterations, different configurations quickly, had many design review meetings. And then we finally came up with our initial final design, right? Where we're gonna start printing. One of our first questions is what machine are we gonna use or what technology and what material are we gonna print in? They both kind of are integrated because machines can only print in so many materials. The first thing that we identified is in this multi-tool, since this is for a bike, wanted to make sure it was magnetic so we can print something that this can snap up to and up into the bike. We know by default 17.4 pH material is magnetic, and pretty much all of our printers run that material, so that was a good material to choose to start. Then the second question is, which printer are we gonna go ahead and print this on? Eventually, we wanted to do production on this part in case we have a large trade show. We wanted to print maybe 100 to 200 to 300 parts. Although we could have started with some of the prototyping printers, like the Studio, like the Exact Metal printer, ones that you can do one copy, check it out, one more copy, and check it out. Instead of that, we just defaulted to the printer that we were gonna end up in, which is the Desktop Metal Shop system. Like with any technology, you're gonna face many challenges as you're learning, as you're ramping up. Like I said previously, you know, we'll test our technology, we'll test the software. One of the first challenges that we ran into when it comes to the shop system is the depowdering stage. After the parts get printed, they go into an oven, a cross-link oven, and that has two purposes. One is to suck the moisture out of the actual powder. It's basically a block of powder with the parts embedded inside. And the second is to make sure it hardens the binder. Otherwise, when you grab the part, it's gonna be able to, you know, you're gonna break it easily. Once the parts come out of the cross-link oven, now you have to depowder them. It's in a cake of powder, and you're basically what you're doing is you're digging them out of that cake of powder. While we were ramping up with the technology, we realized that certain geometries are gonna favor the depowdering stage, others are not. You know, because it's still in the unsintered state, what we call the brown state, if the part is too thin, for example, as you pass the brush over it to clean it, or if you have like an air gun or air hose, we noticed that very, very thin features were just gonna blow off. And that's just the nature of the technology, that's how it works, right? So what we realized is we had to kind of redesign our multi-tool in a way that when it gets to the depowdering stage, it was gonna be strong enough to withstand the cleaning of the part. It was a very easy thing to do, but we realized, oh, that's one thing I have to factor in. When I'm creating a design with the shop system process, I have to factor in the depowdering state. Once we got through that, we came up with our final design, and then we were able to push it to the next phase, which is the sintering, and that's when it actually gets hardened. Challenges with dimensional accuracy and the form of the part. That's something that's inherent with any metal manufacturing process. metal is always gonna bend, deform. In the case of this part, as it's sitting on the actual plate, there's forces that are happening between the bottom surface of the part and the actual plate that it's sitting on, right? So you have to remember, when this part comes into the sintering furnace, it's coming in pre-deformed, so that when it forms, or when it heats up, it actually deforms to its final correct state. The question is, what shape do you need this part to be in before the sintering phase, so that once it deforms to its correct state? In the MIM industry, that's really an art. You have people that have been doing it for decades. They can look at a shape of a part and know where it needs to change, where it needs to warp. One, I don't have that decades of experience. My team doesn't either. And that's where desktop metal has really risen above, because they created a software that simulates what happens inside the furnace. It actually creates, after the simulation, it creates the pre-deformed shape. And when it finally comes out, it's pretty close to the final correct shape. That was very important for us. The first iterations that we passed through the sintering phase, we realized that when we got the part out, these two hex areas were bowed in and these guys here were bowed out. It really has to do where you have the concentration of density and the change of density as you go through the part. So these guys are bowed in, this part here was twisted. So we took our first couple of shots and we were like, oh wow, this is not gonna work for machining, which was gonna be the final phase, right? So we're thinking down the road, we're thinking manufacturing, we're not just thinking 3D printing. That took us to life sintering. We had to dive into life sintering, just got some documentation that desktop metal provides, and that showed us how to use it. But now the next logical phase is to get experience in it. So this was a great learning experience. We did our first life sinter, put that in the printer, it printed, we got the results, and the process is that you scan that and you feed the scan back into the life sinter software, and that learns what happened, right? It learns, okay, I thought it was going to do this, but it actually did this. What life sinter does, it tweaks it a little bit more so that your final shape the second time around is pretty precise within the parameters that the printer is spec'd out to be. Again, that's just part of understanding the full solution, the full technology. When it comes to metal, it's not just printing, right? It's not plastic printing. Plastic printing, you put the shape in there, there's really nothing to consider as far as physical forces acting on the part while it's being heated. It just prints. So when it comes to metal, there's several factors that you have to take into account. And sintering, deformations, physical forces in the furnace, all of those really had a play in pushing us in the direction of life sintering is a must, right? That's not optional when it comes to the shop system. And it almost guarantees that you're gonna come up with the form, shape, and dimensional accuracy that you need to go to the next phase. After we sinter the part, before we machine the parts, we have to have them heat treated. When they come out of the furnace, they come out with a Rockwell hardness of about 26 HRC. And that's very, very soft if you're gonna be using this as a tool. Now, stainless steel is soft, so the only way to get more hardness out of it is to have it hardened. We did some research. We reached out to one of the companies that we had a communication with at Solar Atmospheres out here in Pennsylvania. They have different divisions, but that's the one that's closest to us. And they were excellent at educating us, heat treatment, what's right for this, what's specific for 17.4 pH, and the process that they came up with, which was best for what we were looking for, was the H900 condition. So they would do a solution treatment, then an aging process, and that would bring this up to about 42 HRC. Tooling should be about 50 HRC, so 42 gets us really close, and we're very happy with the results. We went to Solar Atmospheres, they gave us a nice tour, and it was very impressive what they do there. Their services have a pretty wide range. And one of the things that impressed me was their furnaces can be anywhere from a size of a basketball up to a freight trailer. They literally just take tons of parts and just put them in this giant vacuum furnace. For our purposes, you know, we just use one of the medium-sized furnaces. And with that medium-sized furnace, we were able to get about 400 of these parts in one batch, in one lot. Once they come out, I mean, they're great. After that, they're ready for machining. They have the hardness that's required for the application, for the function, and we're ready for the next step. Cimquest has been representing Mastercam for about 32 years. We're the leading Mastercam reseller. We have talented application engineers in different offices in New England, here in Branchburg, in Pennsylvania, down south in Virginia. And one of the things I appreciate about those application engineers, as well as the 3D printing application engineers, is that they come with real world experience. They're not just somebody that's now adopting this technology. So after they understand what we represent, they're really able to grab onto that, make a success out of it, and help the customer make a success out of it. One of the feedback that we got from the Mastercam team when they reviewed our final design was there are things that we can do to the actual CAD file to make it easier for them on the machining side. And that's the advantage of having both expertises, right? Additive manufacturing, CAD, and on the other side, Mastercam, right? Machining. So they came back to us and they said, well, when we machine this part, we're gonna do it in two setups. We're gonna put the vise in, which was 3D printed here with our HP printer, grip the part, machine both hex keys, and then from there, we were gonna flip it over and then machine both hex keys here. That's all fine. And the way they do that is they come down with a probe. They have to touch off on the surfaces and find where the centers are to make sure that the axes are aligned and that you have enough material when they go and machine that. Because we did leave extra material, but you know, it just varies where the part can be sitting inside the vise. We had originally, just from a CAD designing standpoint or a product design standpoint, we just took the final geometry of the hexes and we just offsetted them like 50 thousandths of an inch and saying, that's gonna guarantee that they have enough material. From the machinist point of view, that greatly increases the time of probing because now he has to touch off several faces to find a center. Now he has to touch off six faces. So what we did is, instead of that, he suggested that we do an actual cylinder. Forget about the hex concept design. We did a cylinder, and that way he can just touch off 3 points. And with 3 points, the machine or the software can find the center of the axis. Having all the equipment needed, right, went into SOLIDWORKS, created one more revision, changed our drawings, made sure that was an actual cylinder, all four of them. And then that decreases cycle time by a few minutes, which really matters when you're gonna go a long way around and produce many of these parts. Again, that's just another example how having both teams in the same company supporting this product is essential. You can't just have people that know additive manufacturing. You can't just have people that know CAD really well. You can't just have machinists, right? This is an all-in-one solution. And that's one of the biggest advantages of working with Cimquest is that we have all these solutions, all of this expertise, all under one umbrella. Now that we're in full production with the multi-tool, we're doing about 3 builds a week. And we decided to stay with a 4-liter build. The printer can do 4 liters, 8 liters, 12, and 16. It has a large capacity. But through a lot of testing of a variety of parts, talking to Desktop Metal, talking to other of our customers that are using this full time, one of the suggestions that we came out with is a 4-liter build is a sweet spot. Even though it's the smallest build, it's easier to depowder, it's more manageable. We realized we can do maybe 2 prints, 2 full builds in 1 day. We can just start to stack those parts up as they travel through the cycle, through the shop system cycle. So we have it down right now. We even have like a chart of what machine has to start when, what hour things will be cool enough to start taking them to the next phase. And my team and I came up with that chart so as to maximize one shop system solution and how many builds can you actually pump out of it finished sintered parts in 1 week. My takeaways from this project, I think it's very important to be realistic when you're gonna adopt a new technology. It's not just hitting print and going, right? It's first getting trained on the technology, and then you might wanna test it with some current projects that you have at hand to get even better understanding of it. But more importantly, understand that there's a ramp up time, right? There's a validation phase. There's tweaking involved. And you're gonna have roadblocks and obstacles independent of what manufacturing process you use. Right? You have a brand new design, how are you gonna manufacture it? And once you decide, then you have to move forward. Many times you have to lean on the experts. This is why we do internal projects. This is why we use our equipment. This is why we don't limit ourselves to files that are provided by our vendor that everybody's printing that have been proven to work. We'll come up with our own parts so that we can really test the technology and feel comfortable with what we're selling, comfortable with what we're representing and what we're supporting on. That was the biggest takeaway for me. There's a ramp up time. Leverage the experts. In this case, good news for our customers, we're the experts. We're doing it, we've done it, we're continuing to do it. So that's important to keep in mind and be realistic as far as that whole process and what it involves. So somebody that's getting into metal additive, there's two groups of people. If they're coming from the plastic FDM or plastic printing, right, industry, they already have a certain fundamental knowledge of what printing is, different technologies, right, and how it works. It's not as overwhelming. For people that know nothing about printing and they're starting with the fundamentals, it can be a little bit more overwhelming for them. Regardless of where you start, if you have knowledge already, if you have no knowledge, I think step one is reaching out to Cimquest, because this is where we have the experts. Everyone on my team knows how to run every printer in this office, and we represent various vendors. I have each one dedicated to becoming a subject matter expert to one or two technologies, although all of us run all the printers. And that's on purpose, because when somebody wants to jump into the metal printing additive space, basically what we do is we can bring them here, and step number one is educating them on what's out there, right? What technologies do we represent? Step two, what are you trying to do? Step three, helping them identify what technology will suit their needs. If it's overwhelming or not, Cimquest does a phenomenal job in taking you by the hand, walking you through in this whole process. We've had a variety of customers that this is the first time they're getting into metal printing. They're a little nervous, you know, they hear a lot of things. Ooh, powder, it's you know, hazardous. If it's that bad, we wouldn't be able to sell it, right? So there has to be a way to control it. There has to be a method, a SOP, right, a process. And that's the process that we do very well so people can stay safe and print a lot of good parts, just be successful.